In this chapter, we'll learn about our natural resources, that is land, soil and water. We already know that Earth is a unique planet in our solar system because this is the only planet where life exists. And there are four spheres: lithosphere, made up of land is basically called lithosphere, atmosphere, hydrosphere and biosphere. Earth is divided into two parts, land and water. Land covers almost 30% and water almost 70%. Now coming on to the land resources. The most important natural resource which all human activity is based on is land. We need land for doing everything, for growing crops, we need land for building houses, for constructing roads, for railway tracks, and for every activity we need land. So lithosphere consists of loose materials called soil. It is a combination of organic and inorganic matter. We have already learnt about these things in our previous classes also. From where do we get organic matter? From the bacteria and plants and animals that live and die on the earth's surface. And inorganic matter come from the rocks. So the organic component, which consists of dead and decomposed part of plants and animals, is called humus. The inorganic component comes from rock particles and minerals such as iron, lime, etc. Soil is formed as a result of a long continued weathering process of rocks. About 90% of the world's population is inhabited in the plain areas of the alluvial soils. We know that alluvial soil is the most fertile soil and it is found in mostly northern plains. And it covers 90% of the world's population resides in with this very fertile soil. And sparse population, that is less population, is found in areas of high altitudes, deserts, equatorial forest regions, because the conditions here are not very suitable. The areas are inhabited by people who are engaged, and the temperature is either too hot or too, the temperature is either very high or very low. The slopes are very steep. There are additional problems of water, transportation, etc. Now, what is land use? See, land is used for various purposes, which we have already discussed. So this is called land use pattern, the pattern in which land is used for various activities. This is the definition which you have to learn. Now, on what factors does this land use depends? In simple language, on what factors will it depend whether how will I use the land? So if the land is very fertile, then I'll use it for agriculture. If the land is not that fertile, I can use it for building houses if the nearby areas are developed. So there are basically two factors. One is physical factor and the another is human factor. Physical factors includes relief, soil, climatic condition, mineral resources, etc. And the human factor, like density of population and the technological and social requirement of the people. Whether the region is populated or not, whether the technology is developed or not, those factors will also determine the land use pattern. Now, according to scientific norms, 33% of the world should be under forest to maintain ecological balance. But at present, only 31.6% of the world is under forest. These are the facts which you have to learn. And then a question arises that why do we have to plan to use the land properly? Because land is a limited resource. If we'll use the land in unplanned manner, then a time will come when we won't get land to continue our further activities. Therefore, just like we need to plan everything, like we need to plan the forest use, water use, etc., similarly we need to plan the land use pattern. Now coming on to the next topic, that is soil resources. So the question arises, why is soil called a resource? Because it is a resource for farmer, it is a resource for animals living on it, it is a resource for plants. So everything, and we know that everything depends on plants, so soil is a type of resource. Now what are the factors that affect soil formation? These are the factors. The parent rock, the original rock from which soil is formed by the process of weathering, is known as parent rock. Example, black soil of India is derived from the lava rock. So the type of rock will decide the type of soil formed. Next is the topography, that is whether the area is mountainous or plateau region or plain region. That will determine the thickness. We can easily understand that in mountainous regions, the thickness of the soil will be very less because the slope is very steep, so the soil will be shallow. On the other hand, at gentle slopes, you can see in plains, the soil cover will be thick. Next is climate. Climatic factors include temperature and rainfall. If temperature and rainfall both are high, then soil formation will be very high. So the rate of soil formation will be fast. See, in Rajasthan, due to extreme difference in day and night temperatures, rock expand during the day because of the heat and it contracts during the night. So because of this repeated expansion and contraction, it tends to break. And it seems like this is a very simple process, but this much size of rock will break and become this, then gradually it will become a tiny soil particle. So it takes thousands of years. Similarly, in regions of heavy rainfall, soluble rock materials easily get dissolved and washed away by running water. Thus, it affects the soil formation. Next is vegetation cover. Sometimes, when plants grow near a rock, then the roots tend to go inside the cracks of the rock. And as the roots expand, the cracks deepen, thus leading on to the soil formation. Also, this is one factor. Second factor is that remains of dead or decomposed plants and animals provide humus to the soil, which enriches the fertility of the soil. The soil of densely forested area is generally very rich in humus content. Last factor is time. Time gives maturity to the soil. Soil formed in 100 years will be thinner than soil formed in 200 years. Therefore, it is written the time gives maturity to the soil. Although soil is a renewable resource, yet it takes thousands of years to complete a thin layer of soil on the earth's surface. Now, fertile soil is essential for agriculture. It helps in maintaining food security of the world because it provides better facility for agriculture. We already know the definition of soil erosion. The top layer of the soil is removed by natural agents such as water, wind, glacier, etc. and by mankind's unwise actions such as deforestation, overgrazing and mining. When we remove the forest cover because of agricultural activities or to construct a new factory or house, then the soil gets loosened up and they tend to flow away with wind, water, glacier, etc. and that leads to soil erosion. So how can you control soil erosion? Or rather, how can you conserve soil? There are various ways. You have to learn these points. Afforestation, this is quite obvious that the more plants we plant, the more soil will be conserved. Rows of trees or shelter belts are planted in desert regions to protect the fields from wind erosion. Like various plants will be planted. This is called the rows of trees or shelter belts. And when the wind will blow, these trees will act as barrier and the soil will not get blown away. Overgrazing should be stopped. Deforestation should be stopped. Floods should be avoided. Terrace farming and contour plowing should be encouraged across the hill slopes. So this is contour plowing. And terrace farming, you must have seen this in movies or in hilly regions where the farming is done in steps along a hill so as to reduce soil erosion. And scientific agricultural practices like rotation of crops, strip cropping, etc. should be systematically followed. Now coming on to our next topic, that is water resources. Now, just as soil was a resource, similarly water is also a resource because we need water for various activities. These are a few facts which you will have to learn. How much percent of water is available as ground, how much is available in glaciers and such. Now, the main source of fresh water is rainfall. The rainwater continuously gets recycled in nature through evaporation, condensation, precipitation, which is known as hydrological cycle. What we had learned till now was known as water cycle. The same is basically hydrological cycle. We also know the fact that water distribution in earth's surface is not even. Now, fresh water is abundant at places which receives heavy rainfall, whereas availability of water is less in the areas where rainfall is low. The average annual precipitation of the world is estimated to be 1050 millimeters per year or 2.9 millimeters per day. These are the facts which you have to learn. Also, you have to learn the regions of high rainfall and the regions of low rainfall. Pollution of water, you know, when water gets contaminated due to the presence of various chemicals, then that is called polluted water, and the process is called pollution of water. Polluted water can cause diseases like cholera, jaundice, typhoid, etc. Multipurpose river valley projects. When a dam is constructed, it is not only constructed to store water, it serves many purposes, like it generates electricity, it stores water, it controls flood. So a single dam serves many purposes, therefore it is called multipurpose river valley projects. This is written here, and these are the examples which you have to learn: Damodar River Valley Project, Hirakund Dam in India, Ashwan in Egypt, Hoover Valley in USA, and so on. Now, there are few disadvantages of dams also. When a dam is being constructed, the surrounding region has to be cleared, so excessive deforestation occurs. If the forest is not covered, or all the trees cannot be cut, so the forest remains submerged in underwater. River water gets diverted. The people in the from the surrounding villages have to be dislocated, so population gets displaced. Aquatic life gets affected. It results in soil erosion because of deforestation. And during excessive rain, we know that floods are caused because even the dams are not able to control all the water. Now, how can we conserve water? Water harvesting, we know that we should harvest rainwater also. The surface water runoff can be minimized by having vegetation cover. What do you mean by surface water runoff? See, I have taught you this many times. If a rain is falling on a cemented plain, then all the rainwater will flow. None of it will be absorbed. A very small amount of rain will be absorbed. But if it is flowing in a forest, then most of the rainwater will be absorbed because the soil will absorb, the roots will absorb. So that is what we have to minimize: surface water runoff. The demand of water for industries can be met by recycled water, so water should be recycled. Domestic demands can be met by the same recycling methods or reusing water, which has the water which we use for washing vegetables can be used to water our plants. Water can be saved by adopting modern methods of irrigation, drip irrigation, sprinkler methods, etc. Rainwater can be impounded by making dams across the rivers. Water can be conserved by installing water fixtures such as sensor taps in public places. Sensor taps are quite common in malls. What are sensor taps? The taps through which water will fall only when we take our hand towards it. And maintenance of lakes and ponds also helps in increasing the aquifer of underground water. Water can be conserved by educating and sensitizing people towards the urgent need to conserve water and not to waste fresh water. This is an important point. We should create awareness regarding such problems. So that is how we can conserve water. So what we learnt in this chapter was why land is considered as a resource, how can we conserve soil, how is soil formed, and why is water called a resource, how is water conservation done, and what are multipurpose river valley projects, what are the advantages and disadvantages of